So the other points that people have been interested in are called the collinear solutions. We're going to look along the line of primaries. So now we will consider what we ignored last time, which was y equals zero, which means the x-axis. I wanted to highlight the x-axis. Somewhere along that x-axis, there are other equilibrium points. So where are they? In this case, we're not going to use R1 and R2. We'll still use X and Y, but we've already said what Y is. Y is zero. Okay, that's easy. So now we could just look at critical points of the effective potential along the X-axis. So if I were to write U bar X zero, right, set Y equal to zero, what will we have? Well, we'll have 1/2 X squared minus 1 minus mu over R1, but I'm going to write R1 this way. Absolute value of x plus mu minus mu over R2, but I'll write R2, since we're restricting to the x-axis, it's absolute value of x minus 1 minus mu. And then we have that other term, 1/2 mu 1 minus mu, but that won't really affect things. So these are the collinear points. To find critical points, we need to take the partial derivative of this. But let me first show you a plot of what it looks like. And this is for a value of mu equal to 0.1. So pretty large. You know, with computers, it's pretty easy to draw this thing. So this is for mu equal to 0.1. So M2 is there, M1 is there. And so you could see there are some peaks, some critical points. So just using standard methods of calculus, you can show that there should be 3 critical points, 1 in each of 3 intervals along the x-axis. And M1 and M2 sort of delineate those intervals. So there's going to be 1 in this interval, 1 in this interval, and another in this interval. So maybe we'll start with the one that includes L1. So the one that's between M1 and M2, you could take the derivative of this U bar along the x-axis and find it. So to find them, find the equilibria, we look at partial U bar x zero partial x and set it equal to zero. That'll give us critical points. And that turns out to give us a quintic polynomial, or a fifth order. So not quadratic, not even third order or fourth order, but a fifth order polynomial. Way that it's usually done is you solve not for x, but for the distance from a primary. So how would we do this? Let's consider the equilibrium that's between M1 and M2. That's the one that up here we've called L1. If I do the masses, here's M1, here's M2. There is some point here that's L1. We'll call the distance between these two gamma 1. So the computation is usually done looking for gamma 1. The distance in terms of the non-dimensional units of L1 from M2 is gamma 1, which is the real root of, I'll give the actual polynomial. So the polynomial looks like this, gamma 1 to the fifth power minus 3 minus mu, gamma 1 to the fourth, plus 3 minus 2 mu, gamma 1 to the third, minus mu, gamma 1 squared. Ooh, running out of room. Shrink this up, put it over here. Plus 2 mu gamma 1 minus mu equals 0. So you can find the real root of that polynomial. And there's a similar one for gamma 2. Both of these are in the book. And there's also a similar equation for gamma 3. There are 3 points, L3, there's L2, and like I said, usually it's these gamma things that people solve for. It's gamma with respect to the nearest primary, or for L1 and L2, it's always with respect to M2. And for L3, you do it with respect to M1. So you could solve this polynomial. We could code this up pretty easily in MATLAB and find it and get an answer. So if you look for roots, let me just calculate this for something simple. I'm going to use mu of 0.1, which is pretty large, very large. Then gamma 1 equals to several digits. It's 0.29096. And remember, the distance between the two primaries is 1. So that means it's almost 30% of the way to M1. That's for mu equals 0.1, which is, like I said, really large. Historically, some effort has gone into finding series expansions for solutions of this quintic polynomial. And there's a couple that are most useful for us. So there's an approximation. It's that gamma 1 equals something called RH, which is a certain distance that you can calculate. Actually, let me say what RH is. RH is mu over 3 raised to the 1/3 power. It's called the Hill's radius. And it's something like a sphere of influence. It's the Hill's radius or Hill radius. So this expansion is gamma 1 equals RH 1 minus 1/3 RH minus 1/9 RH squared, etc. And gamma 2, so the distance from the secondary to L2 is also to leading order, it's the same thing, RH. So 1, but then this is a plus 1/3 RH minus 1/9 RH squared. And then the expansion goes on from there. So this would tell us that L1 is always going to be closer than L2. In fact, if we put in mu of 0.1, let me just calculate the Hill's radius. For mu of 0.1, we get RH is 0.322. So it's kind of close. If we added up the entire series expansion, we keep getting closer and closer. For smaller values of mu, this is a better approximation. If I were to really calculate gamma 2 is going to be something greater than RH. The distance to L1 will be less than RH, but the distance to L2 will be greater than RH. And this turns out to be 0.3597. So it is in between. We've got that and that. This is for mu of 0.1, just very large, I said. Let me show what the locations look like. So this is for mu of 0.1. So you've got L4, L5, x of L1 will be 1 minus mu minus gamma 1. X of L2 will be at 1 minus mu plus gamma 2. Which you could hopefully convince yourself. So 1 minus mu is 0.9. And then we're subtracting off for this one about 0.3. So we've got it at about 0.6. And looking at the scale here, that's where L1 is. Here's L2. It's 0.9 plus 0.35. So it's at about 1.25. And that's where we see it. And then if you were to calculate gamma 3, you can find out where L3 is. And then L4 and L5 are always the easiest. They'll always be in between the two masses. Exactly in between the two is the X value. And then the Y value is square root of 3 over 2. So that's where they are. This interpretation of this Hill radius, I don't know the history. I know there was an astronomer named Hill who did quite a bit of work trying to study the stability of the moon's motion in the Earth-Sun system. And so he apparently came up with some radius. But you could think of it like a sphere of influence that kind of goes between L1 and L2. So the radius here, you can call this the Hill sphere if you want. So in 3D, there is some sphere around the secondary that kind of includes L1 and L2. It's kind of like the sphere of influence that's used in the patch conic approach. Like if you're in the Hill sphere, especially if you're moving at kind of slow speeds, you're definitely going to be under the influence of the mass M2. even moving at large speeds. Also, if you recall some of those drawings of the zero velocity contours, this is just by hand. I'm trying to give you an idea here. That's actually not too bad. This is M1 and this is M2. Well, the region here is actually the Hill sphere. So to leading order, you could approximate the size of that region where you would be bound to M2, and it's this Hill sphere. So it is a useful concept. It has a different scaling than the usual radius of the sphere of influence. I think for the sphere of influence, that's proportional to mu to the 2/5, where now we've got something in the three body problem that's proportional to mu to the 1/3. Historically, these collinear ones were found first, and they were found by Euler. And yet we call them Lagrange points. We even put L in front of them in honor of Lagrange, but Euler found them first. And he wrote a paper, and we can even look it up. Everything was in Latin back in those days. This is 1767. So these solutions are older than the United States. If you know any Latin, you might be able to figure out what he's doing here. This is his figure one. And so he's basically saying, if you have three masses, trium corporum, three masses, there will be an equilibrium when they are all in a line, in a rotating frame. So this is actually translated. You could get the translation. I'll post that too. But he's got all these different formulas. It kind of goes on and on in Latin. There's some integrals. The learned people of that day had to write each other in Latin. So there's also an English translation. So this is on the rectilinear motion of three bodies mutually attracting each other. So for whatever reason, we've called these things the Lagrange points. And Euler and Lagrange did know each other. I think Euler would be kind of upset that they got Lagrange's name. But hey, both of these guys have plenty of things named after them. So I don't feel sorry for them. I just wanted to give a sort of summary picture that shows the locations of these, kind of like a bifurcation diagram. I don't know if you know what a bifurcation diagram is, but it just sort of summarizes. So showing the equilibria, and I'm saying it's a bifurcation diagram, but typically a bifurcation diagram shows when equilibrium points change character, like go from stable to unstable, but it could also just show their location. So if I plot down here the X location of the collinear points and also the masses, and then up here, this axis will be mu. Here, the x-axis corresponds to mu equals zero. We've got the secondary. So this is at one, and then here is zero. They're always going to be a constant distance apart. So they'll have the same slope. And L1 grow that way. L2 grows in a different way. L3 starts near about -1. And is also kind of linear. It doesn't have that kind of interesting behavior that we've got right there. So that's the more global picture. Maybe I could label these. This is M1. So it's X equals minus mu. This is M2. So that's X equals 1 minus mu. And then this is L2, L1, and L3. And how they grow as a function of mu. I think what I'm plotting here is up to mu of 0.5, right? But most of the solar system is way down here, all of solar system. In terms of sun-planet mass ratios and planet-moon mass ratios. All right, so I think that's it for today. Next time, we'll talk about the motion near the equilibrium points. In particular, these collinear equilibrium points, because they're the ones, unlike L4 and L5, they're unstable. But that doesn't mean that anything that starts near them will go away. It means that some things may be approaching, some things might be orbiting, and then there are also directions where things go away. But you wouldn't actually put something at this point. Some people have the impression, all right, you'd put something at L1 because it's an equilibrium point. It's an unstable equilibrium point, so odds are any small deviation, it will eventually go along some direction in the phase space where it wants to leave. But if you pick a good initial condition that's nearby the point, not at the point itself, but nearby, you could actually get into orbit around these points. It's also maybe useful to think about in the rotating frame, they are points where if you mathematically could put some kind of particle there, it would stay there. But what does it look like in the inertial frame? In the inertial frame, it'll look like a circular orbit going around the barycenter of the system that doesn't obey Kepler's law. The only thing that should be on a circular orbit obeying Kepler's law is M2. If you have a particle at L1 and at L2, they'd both be on circular orbits with the same frequency, and it'd be the same frequency as M2. So they don't obey Kepler's law. So something to think about. So next time we'll meet again and we'll talk about linearizing around the collinear equilibria. If you're trying to follow in the book, I'll be talking about section 2.6. So what we just did was section 2.5. So we'll be doing 2.6 next time.
If you appreciated this video, please like and subscribe, or just wait and watch the next video in the series. There are links and other materials in the description.